The Magpies have been playing well, but without much reward on the premiership table until now, so they relished the chance to take on the winless Panthers. A 94-point win seemed just reward for a month of consistent footy that lifted them from the bottom two places on the table. Ben Sawford's efforts at the clearances made his home district of West Whyalla proud, as his 13 clearances, easily Port's best, were complemented by 32 disposals and 3 goals. In fact, the only downside to his game was being on the wrong side of the men in white, as he conceded 5 free kicks. He had plenty of support, however, as Hartley Tillow racked up 29 touches, and last week's MVP winner, Jack Johansson, continued his stellar form to have 23 possessions. Each week is a challenge for the Panthers, who are anchored to the bottom of the premiership table, and with only one player, Tom Jolly, finding the ball 20 times, it is hard for Kim Cobb's young men to make inroads into the opposition at times, but their endeavour can't be faulted for large parts of the contest. Jake Corstens and Daniel Nobes both booted 4 goals from limited opportunities, but the ball only entered South's forward 50 on 29 occasions compared to 59 for Port. The ruck battle was an intriguing one all day. Magpie Alex Barnes's 17 disposals, 6 marks and 25 hitouts was counted by the twin South Towers of Brock Godwin-Knott and Peter Steff, who combined for 16 disposals, 7 marks and 36 hitouts, which ensured that both midfields had their share of sharking the taps. Ultimately, however, it was another bridge too far for South and an impressive victory for Port. Central may be second to bottom on the premiership, but their efforts against the Eagles belied that for large portions of the contest. While they ultimately fell 18 points short, coach David Harvey was encouraged by the confidence they showed moving the ball into the forward line at times. Despite having 63 less possessions than the Eagles, they used the ball largely by foot. Of their 298 possessions, 201 were kicks, and reaped the benefits of the more direct football. In fact, only one player, leading possession getter Brad Hunt, moved into double figures with handballs. But when he had 15 kicks of his 26 disposals, you'd think the coaching staff would forgive that. Steve Rusker's good form continued as he found the ball 25 times, but the Bulldogs also struggled to find a key forward on the day. Dallas Hill was the only player to split the big sticks more than once with 3 majors. Take nothing away from the Eagles, however, who seemed to find another gear when necessary. Tom Schwartz again featured prominently with his 30 possessions, only behind Matthew Appleton's 31 touches. Jack Muirhead, however, was a strong focal target in attack, hauling down 10 marks to go with 26 disposals and 3 goals. For good measure, he also had 3 tackles to increase the pressure on the Central's defenders. Shane Grimm's Chargers were able to get their hands on the ball in the aerial sense far more than Central, which was a catalyst for them finding space for set shots. A 110-71 tally in marks was a major difference in a match where both teams were reasonably even for much of the day, apart from the scoreboard at the end. The Double Blues' complete dominance in their game against Glenelg was the key to their 92-point win. To say they held sway over the Tigers in most categories would be a vast understatement. They had an amazing 131 more disposals, 26 more inside 50s and 11 more marks. In fact, the only category Glenelg won were the Frees, having 4 more than Sturt. The Double Blues were led by one of the most dominant individual performances ever seen in the under-18 competition. 203-centimetre ruckman Brody Grundy was the leading possession getter on the ground, with a lazy 33 disposals to go with his 49 hitouts, almost double the total Glenelg tally, and to top it off, 5 goals. The armchair ride given to his midfielders was testament to the quality of his game, as 7 other Double Blues passed the 20 disposal mark. In contrast, it was largely a lone hand for the Tigers, with Nathan Stark the only player to pass that mark. His 29 handlings, 11 marks and 7 clearances were easily their best on a day when they were dominated in most positions. Billy Laurie, however, from the southeast town of Kybie Bolite, worked hard in attack to snare 5 goals, while Jake Resnay worked hard on his defensive side to lay 4 tackles. The day belonged to the home team, however, as Dwayne Wilson and Elijah Ripsich also roamed far and wide to pass the 30 possession mark. Guy Page's effort in gaining 11 clearances was also noteworthy, but it was hard to look past Grundy's dominance as the story of the day. His effort was recognised as the league MVP this week. A spirited first half by the Roosters wasn't enough to hold off the home team at Norwood Oval, who posted a 26-point win. Heath Uni's charges started well with Zach Makins cruising through for 26 disposals, nearly all of which were effective. Tom Reid, hailing from Oraru, the same country as the legendary Mick Redden, also found plenty of it for 24 disposals and was just as good defensively, laying four tackles. Redleg Ben Vidic, however, had other ideas. He was dynamic throughout, amassing 35 possessions and a staggering 20, yes, 20 clearances, as he worked tirelessly to give his team the ascendancy. About the only place he didn't star was on the scoreboard, but I'm sure coach David Odie would forgive that. Mind you, he had plenty of assistance with Peter Bampton's 30 touches, 21 by hand, going well with Alex Mackay, who found the ball 28 times. Norwood, however, did keep their boots clean at times. Of their 370 total disposals, only 165 were by foot, but in doing so, they were able to isolate runners in space impressively. More importantly, however, their effectiveness by hand was excellent, with 89% of their handballs hitting targets. Not surprisingly, they had the lowest mark tally across all teams at the weekend, a mere 43, despite having the highest possession count. Once the margin blew out to 26 points at three-quarter time, however, North were unable to reel that in to a manageable level. In the last term, they did have their chances to bring things back, but they were unable to nail their chances when it counted.